What shall we talk about today?
There's a mic over there, I think.
Yeah, but let me have a look at your beautiful face. Move the mic over.
Beloved Guruji, what is the influence of divine will in our choice and performance of occupations?
In the largest sense, there's nothing else that exists but divine will. Now, man's tendency is this: to narrow down the vastness of divine will to their own will, which consists of nothing else but the egos. So the ego says, I do this and I do that, and yet the ego does nothing at all. For how could the ego function at all without that energizing force that is there of divine will? Now, divine will is a misnomer. It's a fallacy. Divinity has no will at all. Divinity is an energy. But where the will comes in is in manifestation. For that energy, as every kind of energy, has to express itself in some way or the other. And that energy expresses itself in manifestation. This manifestation, in turn, is what has created you. And your very existence, your very creation, is nothing else but manifestation. Now, what is manifestation? Manifestation is the relativity of life, from its grossest level to its highest level, yet it still remains manifestation, which is empowered by that energy. Now, this manifestation is called divine will. When we say, thy will be done, what does it really mean? That may the totality of manifestation cooperate with me. Let me not by my little self fragment it or cut it into pieces. So we try to gather the pieces that we have cut up into the totality of manifestation so that we could merge into manifestation itself. The totality of manifestation. Now, this mergence is the first step that would take place for you to become one with the energy. Manifestation are like waves on the ocean. Up and down and up and down and up and down. But yet, what creates those waves? That is the question. The creation of those waves are because of the energy currents that flow deeper down in the ocean. And that is the energy man has to reach to become divinity itself and not the will. So, here's a process of elimination all the time, where you go from your personal egoified will to divine will, and then you merge away into that infinite energy. Because divine will is not infinite. It has its limitations. It is limited to the structure of this universe, while the energy that we talk about, the impersonal God, if you wish to call it that, is beyond this universe, and yet it penetrates every atom of the universe. So, in this penetration of this energy, we find the entire universe functioning. Because the very act of functioning is a process. It is filled with motion all the time. Nothing can exist in this universe without motion. Everything is moving. Even as we are sitting in this room, we are hurtling through space at thousands and thousands of miles per minute. You take the example of light. 186,000 miles a second. It's moving. Everything is moving. You think you're sitting still there? No, you're moving. For every cell in your body is in motion. Otherwise, you would not be sitting here. Otherwise, you would not be existing. You will disintegrate. So, divine will consists of motion. Right. But now, underlying this motion, there is the stillness where man has to reach and will reach in time to come. And reaching that stillness, you will become part of the motion that controls this entire universe and still be apart from it. You become the observer of the motion. And in that observation, you find that stillness, and yet you're involved in the motion of divine will. So, when it comes to choices, who chooses for you? Your ego chooses. Because the ego is patterned, and according to its patterning, it makes its choice. You are fond of mountains, or someone is fond of the sea. Why? Because you're used to mountains. So you're attracted to the mountains. And if you're fond of the sea, you're attracted to the sea. But yet, man can combine within himself the mountains and the sea together. For what is the difference between the mountain and the sea? You will have just as much ozone up in the hills, the mountains, as you would have at the seaside. What is the difference between the molecular structure between the mountain and the sea? None whatsoever. And then, where did the mountain come from? It was an eruption in the sea that pushed up the mountain. Do you see? And if you climb mountains, you are sure to find, as in my younger days, I used to love mountaineering. And on the mountains I used to find sea shells. So, did the mountain not rise from the sea itself? So why do I discriminate between the mountain and the sea? Now, if I could bring myself to find the oneness of everything, the mountain and the sea, and the land that's in between it, then I am in compliance with divine will. So choices are made because of your preferences, and your preferences are governed by preconditioning. That's why you choose the mountain or you choose the sea. Yes. So, choices are made because of your ego self. And your ego self is nothing else but thought formation. So, the process is simple, really. You unform the formation. And then, when you can do that, you will learn to look, observe yourself and the various processes of the mind that leads you to certain kinds of choices. So you have a vacation. For 2 weeks. Now, are you going to go to New York or Los Angeles? Why? How does that choice come about? Because you might have read up some articles on New York. So you're attracted to New York. You want to go and see the Empire State Building. Or else you might have read articles on California, the 17-mile drive. So therefore you're attracted to that. So choice is a matter of conditioning to repeat again. Divine will does not choose for you. It is your own ego self that chooses. And the ego self, as I said before, is nothing but a whole conglomeration of thought forms. created by yourself, by your environment, by your childhood, by past lives perhaps, who knows? Yes, see. But the greatest area to discover is to have choiceless choice. Now what does that mean? Choiceless choice. Where you do not choose anything, but you flow into everything. And then in that flow, the right path is shown to you. If you should go to New York or to Los Angeles, do you see? Mind you, Los Angeles is quite nice. I like Disneyland. I don't like New York. You can't at night walk through Times Square or through Central Park without getting mugged. Yes, sir. So, it is not a matter of choosing. It is a matter of being chosen. There's the difference. You're chosen to do a certain thing by that divine will. And you just flow with it. Why not? I might have used this analogy before somewhere in some country, I don't know. You sit at the ocean side and you watch all those waves up and down and up and down. But you can enjoy those waves if you become a surfer and surf along on the waves. Then it becomes a sport. It becomes a play. And is life not a play? Actors on the stage, acting away, playing their parts. And yet the actor realizes that if he should play Romeo or whatever, Hamlet, is that, the other, he's not that Romeo and he's not Hamlet. And he's not Julius Caesar either. Right. He's playing a part. So if life could be regarded as just playing a part and to flow with the part, for the director's there to direct you, that energy, that impersonal God, if you would like to use that kind of terminology, is directing you. All the time. So it is the energy which is the empowering force and not divine will. To repeat again, it's a fallacy of all theologies, thy will be done. Thy will is never done without it being empowered by this energy. See, it is the energy that energizes the divine will which constitutes this universe. And after all, this universe is only a process. Only a process. How many universes are not created every day and destroyed every day? How many galaxies are not created every day and destroyed every day? At this very moment, there are thousands upon thousands of stars which are a million times bigger than our little planet Earth that are exploding. So where does divine will come in from if it was not for this energy? Do you see? We got some water, have we? You must put the incense stick on that side, it gets my eyes. Thank you, dear. There is truth in divine will. That is not the sum totality of it all. Divine will is just the entire constitution of this universe. And by we being in harmony with this constitution, our lives can become happier. And automatically, you do not even need to choose anything. Because choosing involves your little mind. Right. So do not choose, but just be chosen. I did not choose to come here, but I was chosen to come here. Do you see the difference? There was some force, there was some power that propelled me to come here. I was ill for 3 months in bed now, recently. And the people in South Africa said, cancel the trip. I said, no. I must go and see my beloveds. Do you see? So it was not a matter of my choice. I was chosen to come. There was some force, a magnetic force perhaps, that pulled me here to be with you. Now these ideas might sound revolutionary to you, but that is the truth and the absolute truth. You go to the dressmaker shop, and you look around at all the various dresses, and then in one moment you say, oh, let me take the red one. And then you look around, you say, oh, this black one might seem better. And then you look around more and you might say, oh, the blue one might be better. Or the pink one might be better. That's just the workings of your mind. Because each and every one of those colors will be good enough for you. Laura will tell you about colors, she's an artist. Everyone would be good for you. Brighten up the face. Create that glow through your meditational practices. And every color suitable. I can put on any color suit and look just as good. Why? Because the inner self reflects itself through your apparel, through the clothing you wear. It's the inner self that's important. It's not the feathers that make the bird. Because the feathers won't be able to exist if the bird was not existing. It's the bird itself. You see, like your turkey today. You turkeys. Oh, life is such fun. Enjoy the fun. And forget about choosing. You don't need to make choices. The lady comes up to me this morning. She arrived late last night, I believe. She came to say hello. A very loved one. And I said, oh, that's a lovely suit you've got on. She said, I specially put the suit on for you to see you. She could have come to me naked. And I would still love her just as much. Yeah. So the feather does not make the bird. The bird makes itself. For the bird is no choice. It is chosen. Yes. So, we try and do this and we try and do that and we want to go to a party next week and we start worrying now, what dress am I going to wear? And you try and pick out a fantastic dress. But you might go to that party and find five other women with the same kind of dresses. Where's your choice? Where is the choice? Just be your natural self and live in compliance with nature itself. For nature constitutes the entire universe. You flow with the current. And even in the river of life, you get knocked about by driftwood or whatever, or by rocks. So what? Get knocked around. It is not your choice. And maybe there might be so many great lessons there to be learned. Oh yes, because everything in life is a lesson in itself. This must be recognized. Every moment that you live is a lesson. But people don't recognize it. How many of you here now, sitting listening to me, is conscious of yourself? Very few. You know why you have lost that consciousness of yourself? Because your attention is riveted on the words I'm speaking. Do you see? But if you couldn't combine that consciousness with my words, and form a unified whole, how much more you'd enjoy it. So choice is also related to one's consciousness, depending how developed the consciousness is, how much awareness you have. Can any of you tell me how many times I blew my nose while I'm sitting here?
Three times?
No.
Five.
You see? Awareness. Be aware. And once that awareness is developed to a certain degree, then choices come on their own. You do not need to choose anymore. You are chosen. You are the chosen people of divinity. Is that not true? That's what all theologies say. Nothing new which I'm telling you. So being the chosen people of divinity, why not remain to be chosen and try and choose things yourself? And when you try and choose things yourself, you say, I am the doer. But you're not the doer at all. You say, I walk up these steps. Are you really walking up those steps? No, you're not. It is that energy that's propelling you to walk up those steps. So if the greater amount of attention, greater amount of consciousness is paid to the energy, rather than saying, I am running up these steps or walking up these steps, life would be much, much better. Yes. So the dominant thought in one's mind should be, I am not the doer, he is the doer. I am not the chooser, he chooses, and I am only the chosen. Did I? 12 o'clock. About an hour, is it? Vidya? Yeah, more or less. Good, fine. Don't stretch your brains too much.